a beautiful, beautiful day. Man, absolutely gorgeous. 2 weeks in a row of just perfect weather. We praise God for that. And so thankful for all of you being out here. And I miss everybody. I still feel so far away. I keep, Rebecca's reminded me, she goes, remember, you can't walk towards them very much. But sure, I'm thankful for you being here today. I want to give you a quick update on a couple of things. We will be sending, and I don't have the exact number, but approximately $6,200 overseas to the church in Ukraine. So thank you so much for all that you have done. God is so good. The deacons, even they, you know, when I got it, I brought it before them. They said this could be really exciting. And David brought it before you. So Dr. Woodbridge was off the hook when I talked to him earlier this week and told him, because they simply were looking at, you know, he said, look, this is what we have. We're not expecting you to do everything, maybe part of one. I said, well, let's see what God does with his people. I said, we have a very generous people, and God is just one of the things that he has affirmed in my heart repeatedly. In short, you can't outgive me. So whatever I provide for my ministry, use it for that, I'll keep supplying it. And so we're just so excited. So thank you for your faithfulness. And we praise God for his as well. So thank you so much for that. What? You can't hear me? Oh, boy. It's on. Can you guys, is it coming out of that speaker? Coming out of that speaker?
I got it.
I can get, okay, thank you, Vern. All right. I'll wake up the neighbors. We got no problem with that. I wanted to begin here this morning, and also just to remind everybody, we have the lyrics as well as the sermon outline right over here. So you guys can take a copy of those if you like them. But I wanted to open our time here this morning before the message in Psalms 119, verse 18, and also in verse 73. Two very prevalent scriptures and passages to me. Verse 18 says, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. And then in verse 73, it says, your hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn your commandments. I tell you, we should pray that often, but perhaps none greater as far as the opportunity, the times to do that, than when we get ready to come into God's word. And so this morning, we're going to be looking at the second part of this mini-series about the impact of God's word. So let's just start our time in prayer. I want to give everybody an opportunity just to close your eyes, bow your heads, and just in the stillness of everything, just pray to God in your heart, and then I'll open us in a word of prayer here this morning. Almighty Infinite Father, we praise you for your greatness. We thank you and praise you for your faithfulness. Father, even the beauty of coming together in this day, in the beauty of the day that you have made, thank you for it. And God, we pray now, individually as well as corporately, that you would open our hearts, open our minds, teach us some wondrous thing from your law. Teach us to understand your commandments. Father, I pray that you would speak through your word. For those who may be hurting this morning, may they be encouraged and healed. For those who are weary, may you give them strength. For those who are lost, I pray that they would find you. Lord, we need you, and as we break open your word here now, we need you evermore to speak through man, to speak, Almighty God, the holy things that you have given to us, and may they be rightly divided. May you have the preeminence. May man be hidden behind the authority of your word. Thank you for the people that you have gathered together here today. May we be of one accord, one mind, one heart, as we listen to one voice of the one true living God. In the name of Jesus, we pray all things, and in that name alone, we pray everything. Amen. So go ahead and turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 9, if you're not there already. Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 3, the impact of God's word. Now remember, last week I talked about it really being an introduction. We looked at chapter 8, verses 1 through 12. We looked more in that light last week at the response to God's word. And so just as a reminder, what the people did there in Nehemiah chapter 8, as the wall had been completed, as they came together to worship, in verse number 1, they came and they asked Ezra to read from the word of God or from the law of Moses. So we see that they had a hunger for the word. Then we see that they had a hearing with understanding. They listened to comprehend, to heed God's word. And then they partook and had an active engagement in the public reading of the word. Much like what we're doing here today, they were outside, except they were in the public square, the most public forum of the city in front of the water gate where everybody would come and gather their water supply. And we talked about that is where God's word belongs, in the public forum of every facet of our lives. Then we see they had a proper respect for the word. Remember, they all stood up when Ezra began to read. And then they responded in worship to the word of God. And then it says they were still. The Hebrew means fixed, in the presence of God. Now remember, how long did Ezra read? Yeah, for half the day, or 6 hours of the daytime. 6 hours. They were mesmerized. They just stood in awe of the word of God, and they listened to God's word. So they were still in the presence of the word. Then they wept because of the word. And we're going to be touching more on this morning. But remember, looking back at last week, the reason they wept, they were reminded of who they were, who God was, what he had done for them, what he had brought them out of, and also what they were not doing. In other words, they were under conviction. So they wept because of the word. And then the priest told them, listen, this is not the intent today. This is not why we have told you these things, that you should go and rejoice and praise and worship. And so we see that they rejoiced because of the word. Why did they rejoice? Because then they understood what it was that God had delivered them from. That God's grace and mercy and power and redemption and leading and guidance of all these things. And they began to rejoice. And so we're going to be looking at three key elements now, the impact of God's word, Nehemiah 9. In verse number 1, it says, now on the 24th day of this month, the children of Israel were assembled with fasting in sackcloth and with dust on their heads. The first thing that we want to point out, and kind of working backwards here in the verse, the sackcloth, that was a very coarse animal's hair. There was nothing becoming about it, okay? As well as the fasting and the dust or the dirt that they put on their heads. These are all signs of intense grief, of lamenting and mourning. But then we want to point out, as we hold that thought for just a moment, we want to point out what this verse shows us. There's nothing in God's word that is there for page filler. So why does it tell us that it was on this day, the 24th day of this month? This holds very key significance in understanding the depth of this. Remember, I mentioned last week, and we know that this month in chapter 8 and verse 2 is the seventh month, Tishrei, of the Jewish calendar. It's the equivalent of what we would call the Jewish New Year. Rosh Hashanah is what it is referenced to today. And on the first day, you had the Feast of Trumpets, and it was announcing the arrival of this celebration period. And the Feast of Trumpets was introducing the 10 days of awe leading up to the Day of Atonement. And it was, again, reminding them of who they were, who God was, and a time to contemplate their position before God. Am I right with God? Am I in a right standing in relationship with the Lord? And so then on the 10th day was the Day of Atonement, which was the traditional lamenting and mourning for their sins. The atonement, the Day of Atonement. It is what it says. They were being atoned for their sins. And then on day 15 through 21, it was the Feast of Tabernacles. That was the celebration of God's provision and deliverance in the wilderness during the 40 years of wandering. Now, why is this so significant? Because in verse number 1, it says on the 24th day of this month, the feast and the celebration, especially in talking about the Day of Atonement, had passed. The Day of Atonement, where the traditional lamenting of sin was 14 days prior. And here they have on sackcloth, they're fasting, and they're covering themselves with dirt. What's the point? The point is this. The people didn't delay in repenting of their sin. They didn't wait until the next prescribed moment. They didn't wait until the next feast. They didn't wait until the next opportunity. They took advantage of it right then. They heard God's word. They were convicted by God's word, and they responded appropriately by taking their sins seriously and responding immediately. And they asked God to forgive them. They were convicted. This is where we have to ask ourselves this question. How do we respond to the conviction of God's word? Unfortunately, I think what we see, if we're honest, at least in phases of our lives, as a predominant whole in the church, if you will, as a whole, is that we have delay and resistance when convicted by God's word, rather than mourning and repentance. And we ask ourselves, why is that the typical response to the conviction of God's word? I think there's three main reasons. The first one is pride. We don't want to acknowledge our sin. We don't want to accept guilt. And when that takes root in our heart, when another brother or sister in Christ comes, or whatever means God uses to convict us through his word of that sin, you know what the immediate response is? Oh no, you have it wrong. You're the one that has misinterpreted scripture. You're the one that's in the sin, not me. That's an immediate red flag to understand that we're not following after God's conviction of his word. When someone comes, if they have our best interests at heart, if they genuinely are a brother or sister in Christ who love the Lord and say, listen, I love you. And that doesn't change when we sin against one another. But what you've done, what you've said, how you're acting is contrary to God's word. That's wrong. That's sinful. And if you know what our response should be if someone says that to us and we don't see it especially? You know what we should say? Can you show me in God's word? Will you explain that to me? But most of the time, and what I've experienced just in ministry, just in life, we don't want to know what God's word says because we've already developed our own opinion. There's no way that we can be convicted of that. So you have pride as to why we don't respond to God's conviction or the conviction of God's word. The second reason as to why we don't respond as we should to God's conviction of his word is callousness. We've grown to accept it. We've grown accustomed to it. We don't even realize and recognize conviction when it comes knocking. Another way to put that is the spiritually blind don't see their own blindness. How many times I've had discussions with people, and in the past it has been, and we all are susceptible to these things, myself included. But when you start discussing things of a sinful nature in someone's life, And you can, it's a genuine response. You can see the look on their face. They're going, what do you mean? You see, the enemy, he disguises himself as an angel of light. There's a reason why God tells us that. There's a reason why he distorted God's truth from the very beginning in the Garden of Eden. There's a reason why he tried to distort God's word in tempting the Son of God himself. There's a reason for that. And the reason is because he knows God's word many times better than most Christians do. And we then, because we don't understand and we aren't grounded in God's word, we become susceptible to what he tells us is okay. And then we'll actually try to use God's word to support sinful behavior. And the majority of times when this callousness has taken place in people's hearts, one of the main fruits of that is that we surround people of like-mindedness with us. Typically, what I've seen in life is that people who are living in unconfessed, unrepentant sin do not want to hang around with people who are walking right with Jesus, because their lifestyle alone will convict them of the sin that they're in. Not to mention, if you're really in love with your Savior and you really love people the way God tells us that we are to love them, when we see them with an element of sin in their life, we don't empathize with them. We don't sympathize with them because of their sin. But we tell them, because I love you, this is what God's word says, and that's contrary to God. If we feel sorry for people more than we love them, we'll never confront them with the reality of God's truth, ever. Because we're more concerned about their feelings than we are about their alignment and their spiritual position with the Almighty. That saying, birds of a feather flock together, that's what that's talking about. And so we have this callousness that takes place as to why we don't respond to God's conviction as we should. And the third reason is our sin nature. Simply put, we don't like to surrender what God has convicted us of. Man, how many times, perhaps some of you have known someone, or maybe yourself, where you're going, yeah, I know that sin. I know what I'm doing is sin, but I'm not going to turn from it. Well, that's dangerous ground. But here's the bottom line when confronted with the conviction of God. We have one of two choices. We can accept it and repent, or we can reject it and continue to sin. That's it. There are only two choices. Just last night, I was reading something. I started laughing. I did. I actually laughed out loud. Bella thought I was nuts, but I got a good chuckle out of it. Let me read something to you that I read just last night. When your conscience convicts you, you have only two choices. Now, this is after I put the sermon together. Just for those of you who don't know, I don't put a sermon together on Saturday evening. Okay, that's not the way it works, all right? When your conscience convicts you, you have only two choices. You can gladly confess that what you have done is sin and place yourself once again under the justifying mercies of Christ. Or you can erect some system of self-justification that makes what God says is wrong acceptable to your own conscience. We are all so good at doing this. We are good at pointing to something or someone who justifies what we have done. We are all very good at systems of self-atonement that essentially argue for our righteousness. What is deadly about this is that when you convince yourself that you were right, you quit seeking the grace that is your only hope in life or death. I was like, wow, don't beat around the bush. So when we experience the conviction of God through his written word, when it is spoken, when his word convicts our conscience, when his word convicts our heart, when his word invades our home, when his word invades our nation, Get ready to say, there's no way it's 12 o'clock already. No way. So don't everybody get excited. Hey, 6 hours. Come on. We're doing it in like 45, all right? Our only response, godly biblical response, is to obey what God has shown us. Repent, confess our sin, repent of our sin, and turn to God. We need to stop blaming everybody else for our sin and start accepting responsibility for our own actions. So the first impact of God's word found in verse number 1 is conviction. The second thing that we see, the impact of God's word in verse 2, is what we do with that conviction, confession and repentance. Remember, I've told you this before, don't be content with the conviction. You know, many times we walk away from a sermon, we walk away from time of God's word, we walk away from a time of prayer, we walk away from many things going, whoo, yeah, that stepped on my toes. In other words, yeah, we were really convicted, but nothing changes. We acknowledge the conviction, but we're content with that. It's almost like, do you understand when we get in that kind of spiritual mentality that what we're saying is, I got to come into God's presence so he can beat me up a little bit and then I can go on my way. That's not the purpose of God's conviction. His conviction is to bring us back into alignment with what's right in his eyes. Don't be content with the conviction alone. But let it lead you to confession, that is repentance. Look there in verse number 2. Then those of Israelite lineage separated themselves from all foreigners, and they stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. The first thing that we see is that they separated themselves from all the foreigners. That is, they separated themselves from the people who were not of genuine, pure Jewish lineage. Now understand, they weren't being snobs. Okay, this wasn't a club. This wasn't a clique. This was simply following after God's mandate, God's commandment, God's affirmation from Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 26, amongst other places, that God had called Israel away from the rest of the nations of the world, that they would know him, that they would know that the Israelites belonged to him, that they would bring him glory, and ultimately, just so you understand, so that they would bring the gospel to the non-Jewish nations, which is the Gentiles, as Paul spoke about in the book of Acts. And so they were separating themselves from those who were not completely of the lineage of the Jewish lifeline. But this is what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 2. You don't need to go there. I'm going to read these verses to you very quickly. This applies to us as well. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 7. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble being disobedient to the word, to which they also were appointed. But you, you're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. Why? That you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy but now have obtained mercy. Folks, let me put it to you this way. Difference is essential in being one of God's people, one of God's children. The world has got to see a difference in how we live, how we act, how we walk, how we talk, how we think. And one of the main obstacles, one of the main barriers, one of the main reasons as to why our repentance, or I should say so much repentance, is not effective, is because we refuse to separate ourselves from a sinful world. We refuse to separate our worldview, our opinions, our mentalities, our speech, our entertainment from the sinful world. And so what happens is we start looking around thinking that how we're living isn't sinful because we blend in with the sinful majority. And so when God's word comes to us in whatever capacity and says, hey, look, the light of God is shining upon you, as it says in John 3:17-21, and those in darkness don't like the light because it reveals the things that are being done in the darkness, they look at us and they go, you're the one who has the problem. What do you mean I'm living in sin? What? And you know, just so we got clear on this, I'm not just talking about in the world. Unfortunately, this mentality has seeped deep into God's church. I've heard a pastor say, and I understand it, what they love you for in the beginning, they'll hate you for in the end. Give it to us, Pastor. We love the word of God. You'll like it until it tells you something you take personally. Well, then all of a sudden, who's he think he is? You know, it's interesting. I'm sorry, I'm getting off on like 6 different sermons here. I've had 3 months, y'all. Cut me some slack, okay? There is a laundry list of sermons upon God. Which one do I choose from? Do you know, remember the sons of Korah? Those were the ones who got swallowed up by the ground. Do you know what their opening accusation against Moses and Aaron were? Who do you think you are? We can do what you do. We don't need you. You don't need to be telling us what God's word says. You know what's convicting for that as a leader? Do you know what Moses and Aaron's response was? He fell on his face and prayed. So understand how convicted by God's word and how we're supposed to respond to it. God's done a lot in my heart in these 3 months. One of them is I need to stop praying against the people who reject the things of God and start praying for the people who reject the things of God. And at the top of that list is me. You're going, but you're the pastor. Do you not understand I am of flesh and blood like you? That there are times before I bring God's word to you, I sit in my office and I push myself away from the desk. And like David, when he responded to what God had told him to do in carrying the Ark of the Covenant, different sermon. Just hang in there, okay? And Uzzah reached out and caught the cart when it started to fall off the cart, when it started to fall off the cart, and he died. Do you know that David got mad at God and said, well, how am I supposed to bring the ark up to Jerusalem? I wrote in the margin next to the Bible, how's about obeying what God told you to do? He didn't tell you to put it on the back of a cart, knucklehead. That's why it fell off to begin with. I've got to go with this. You want to know why they put it on the back of a cart? Rather than putting the poles through it and carrying it on their shoulder? It was easier. It was faster. It was more convenient. Does this not describe our attitudes when it comes to treating God's word? Well, I know what he said, but did he really mean to take it to that extreme? What's more convenient for me? What's more comfortable for me? And when we start coming back to these things, we start realizing we need to separate ourselves from the way the rest of the world and the sinful world and the people of the world, or who are just simply contrary to the word of God. We need to separate ourselves from that. We need to come out from amongst that and be different and be separate. As Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17, 14 through 17 actually. But in 2 Corinthians 6 verse 17, that's when Paul quoted Leviticus 20:26 that said, come out from amongst them and be separate. Not be above them, be separate, be different. God says, be holy, for I am holy. So notice now what they did in verse 2 in confessing and repenting their sin. It says they stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. Oh, this is good. I'm going, okay, I get why they confessed their own sin. But, Lord, I can't ask for forgiveness for anybody else's sin. No, read deeper. What was happening here? In short, the people weren't trying to hide from their sin. And they also weren't trying to make excuses for their sin. Yet, Lord, I know that we're a rebellious, stiff-necked, hard-hearted people, but you saw what our forefathers did in the desert, right? Yeah, I know I've slipped into idolatry, which is spiritual adultery, but look at what our forefathers did. Yeah, I know that we're arrogant, rebellious people, but look at who my family lineage is. Does this ring a bell or resonate with us here today? Yeah, I know I struggle with anger, but you don't know who my father was. Yeah, I know that I struggled with sexual immorality, but you don't know who my mother was. Yeah, I know that I've struggled with gossip and lies and hatred and violence, but you don't know where I came from. Does this sound familiar? You see, this is what we all do. Even when we graze up against the conviction of God's word and saying, yeah, I know I'm guilty of that, but it's his fault. It's her fault. It's the church's fault. It's my neighbor's fault. It's my parent's fault. It's my kid's fault. It's my boss's fault. Folks, when we sin, we are responsible for our actions, period. We need to stop making excuses for other people's sin and our sin. We need to start saying, yep, I am sinful, and what they did was sinful. And there's no excuse for it. That's why they confess their iniquities and their father's iniquities. And we need to do the same. They didn't try to hide their sinful behavior. And they didn't try to excuse it by blaming it on someone else. And then the third impact of God's word, worship. Oh, this is beautiful. Look. In verse 3, and they stood up in their place and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for 1/4 of the day. There it is again. And for another 1/4, they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God. Genuine repentance leads to forgiveness. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 10 says that godly sorrow produces repentance that leads to salvation. Not like worldly sorrow that leads to death. What's the difference? Worldly sorrow just makes you feel bad about what you've done. Regret maybe and remorse, but not repent. Godly sorrow, and I painted this picture for you before in the Bible. Godly sorrow breaks our heart because we've broken the heart of our Savior, and it leads us to repenting of it, acknowledging it, confessing it, repenting of it. The difference? Peter and Judas. Judas felt guilty. He went out and hung himself. Peter went out and wept bitterly. And when he came face to face with his Lord on the seashore that morning, he was made whole because his heart was repentant. Jesus was ready to forgive him, but Peter had to repent. Peter had to accept the forgiveness. That's exactly what he did, remember? He jumped out of the boat because he said, if it's you, remember the fish and all that? He said, it's the Lord. Peter jumped into the water. They were like 300 feet out. That doesn't sound like a long ways. You go, please don't do this literally. But you try to swim 100 yards. That's a long ways with your clothes on. He couldn't wait to get to the one who was going to restore him. He didn't run away from it. Jesus wasn't done with him yet. He fed him breakfast, and then he asked him 3 times, do you love me? Phileo, friendship, just that ordinary, do you love me? Well, yeah, Lord. Okay. A little while later, hey, Peter, you really love me? Yes. How many times I got to say this? And then finally, he changed it a little bit. He said, Peter, you agape me.
Are you consumed with me? Do you cherish me and treasure me? Do you love me? And Peter was broken. He said, yes, Lord. And so what did Jesus tell him? Then feed my sheep. And what did Jesus tell him? Don't worry about the ones back there. You have enough to worry about. I've convicted you of what you've done wrong. I've restored you for what you've done wrong. You say that you love me, then live like it. Folks, this is where we got to get to in our repentance in life. When we're convicted by the word of God, not just giving it lip service, but we need to come to the point of saying, I agape you. I adore you. I want to change my ways. I want to stop making excuses. I want to humble myself under the authority of your word. And I want to do what's right in your eyes. What do you say? Genuine repentance leads to forgiveness. And then that forgiveness should lead us to a point of worship and praise to the one who has given us what we don't deserve. Have any of you, I'm not asking for details, have any of you ever had to ask forgiveness of someone of a very egregious offense? Anybody? Okay. All right. So there's like 25% of us that are honest, and everybody else is just like, boy, I'm getting good sun out here this morning. What does he ask for? If somebody does that to you, says, what did he say? There's free lunch after church up at Chips. Just go ask them for it. See what they say. I'm just kidding. When we, and I've been in that situation too, not just something about, hey, you know, whatever it may be, but the egregious offense. There's a lot of things going through your head. What's this person going to do and say? How are they going to respond? Now, I use her as an example. She's not here. She's in North Carolina with her mom and sister, but my wife. What I learned through this woman's actions in this about coming to her and asking her for forgiveness, not knowing how she's going to respond over the years. Yes, there's been more than once. Has drawn me closer to the Lord to understand what forgiveness is all about. And the first few times I'm going, this doesn't make sense. Did you hear what I said? I already forgave you for that. And to get through the mushiness, it made me want to be around her more. I love my wife more when she has forgiven me in those things. And I'm going, how? And the only answer is that she's reflecting the love of Jesus. She's showing what repentance is, but also what forgiveness is that follows. And this is what God tells us in Romans chapter 3 and verse 10. There is none righteous, no, not one. In verse 23 of the same passage, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. In Romans 6:23, it says, the wages of sin, that is what we deserve as sinful beings, and all of us are sinful beings, the eternal spiritual wage of our sin is death. The wages of sin is death, separation from God. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9, it says that God is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to repentance. In Colossians chapter 3 and verses 13 through 14, it says that he has taken the handwriting of requirements that is against us, that is what we owe as sinful beings. God doesn't owe anything. He's righteous. He's holy. He's perfect. He hasn't sinned. But he took what we owe and he wiped it. The Greek means obliterated it out of the way. How did he do that? Having nailed it to the cross. I was thinking about something. I went out for a walk a couple of days ago and just something that was resonating in my mind. In order to go to hell, you got to go around the cross. Because God has said, all have sinned, but I've come to forgive you of that sin. I haven't come to judge you, but to save you. I haven't come to condemn you because you're already condemned. I've come to rescue you. If you can hear these words this morning, understand that these words are not my own. They're the words of God Himself. When we start understanding God's word, we're not only convicted by it, we not only confess and repent of it, but when we start realizing who God is and who we are, it should make us want to praise and worship the one who has given us what we do not deserve. And I think one of the reasons that our worship has become so stagnant as Christians is because we have forgotten who we serve. We have forgotten what He's done. We have forgotten what He brought us out of. We have unknowingly become filled with pride and callousness and the sin nature, and we've accepted that. But understand, in order to worship God, we have to hear and know about God from His Word. Listen to what Romans chapter 10 and verse 14 says. How then shall they call on Him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in Him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Now make no mistake, it's not just talking about the office of a bishop or an overseer, even though that certainly is at the forefront of the proper interpretation and understanding. But preacher in the Greek means proclaimer. A proclaimer of good news, gospel. And each of us are called to walk worthy of the calling that God has given to us. We're supposed to be proclaimers of the good news of Jesus Christ, folks. And maybe we're saying, well, what's the good news? What is it that brings me to the place of worship? Simply put, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whosoever will believe in Him, that means to follow after with the heart, not just to acknowledge with the mind. There's a turning, there's a difference. Whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You say, how do I do that? Romans 10:13. Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. How many of you remember the day you were saved? How many? Well, I hope that's a memorial you never forget. Forgive me for the analogy, but you ever hear that saying, walking on cloud nine? Where's cloud nine? What exactly is that? That never made sense to me. But nonetheless, you're at a high spot. You're in this place of redemption and forgiveness and grace and mercy, and you begin to realize for the first time the difference that Jesus Christ makes when we acknowledge that we're a sinner, when we believe in what He has done by dying on the cross and rising again from the dead 3 days later and calling on His name, Lord Jesus, forgive me, save me of my sins, I profess You as my Lord. When we experience that and understanding what we have been brought out of, does that not make you want to shout praise to your Savior? And yet it's not just at the moment of salvation. This is to be a daily exercise in the Christian life. Please don't shy away from the Word of God for any reason, but don't ever shy away from the Word of God because you're afraid it's going to convict you. Amen. I'll tell you this much. 90% of the time, I think we're going to come across something. If we're in it like we should be, we're going to be convicted a lot. Don't shy away from that. That's God's love saying, I love you enough to tell you, you need to get right here. And this isn't right. You need to get right here. And this is my commandment. And here it is. And when we begin to realize that the conviction of God's word is motivated out of a heart of love, thank you. Thank you. Why do you want to have a relationship with me? I can't comprehend it, but I know that you do because your love abounds. Where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. Let's have every head bowed and every eye closed. Before our musicians come, I just want to ask something here this morning. Got to maintain the distancing, but I just want to ask. Pastor, between last week and this week, maybe even more than that, maybe God has been preparing your heart before you came in contact with this message, whatever it is there anyone here with every head bowed, every eye closed, say, Pastor, please pray for me.
because I am under conviction from the Lord. Anybody like that would just slip their hand up and keep it up. Nobody's looking around. It's just me. Just keep it up. And now, would you say, Pastor, pray for me that I would respond to the conviction by confessing my sin right now. Right now. I want to confess and repent of my sin before God. If that is you, if that is in your heart and your mind, with every head bowed and every eye closed, you don't have to. Matter of fact, that's what we're going to do before I pray. Just in your hearts and your minds right now, in your own heart, in the privacy of your own mind, pray to God right now, Lord, forgive me, whatever it is, right? Now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, is there anyone here to say, Pastor, I'm not certain that I've accepted Christ as my Savior? And I'm beginning to wonder if that's why it's not just sin in my life as a child of God that is keeping the worship in my life stale, but I'm not positive I have actually accepted Christ as my Savior. I'm not sure I've actually acknowledged Him, believed in Him, called on Him. I've been convicted, but I haven't repented. Not the way that I should, not the way God says, but I want to do that today, right now, where I sit, with every head bowed and every eye closed. Is there anyone here that does not know for certain that you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? You don't know for certain that if you were to die today, where you would spend eternity. If that's you, and you want to accept Christ, just slip your hand up where I can see it. Nobody's looking around. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to embarrass you. Almighty God, we come before your holy presence this morning. Oh God, I plead for your people that we would be convicted by your word and your Holy Spirit. I pray that we wouldn't wait for Sunday to get things right with you. I pray, Father, that if there's sin in our lives today, that we would not only acknowledge it and confess it, but that we would repent of it. And then, Almighty Father, in understanding what you have done like the Israelites did, and what you have purged our hearts and our minds of, what you have set us free from, what you have washed us clean of, would lead us to worship and praise our God. Because of you, our sins are cast into the depths of the sea. Let us to sing aloud from our hearts this morning the God that we serve, who has graciously and mercifully forgiven us, Almighty God, even this day. Those who have confessed their sins right now, may they experience the renewing, refreshing power of your Spirit coursing through their bodies and their hearts and their minds and their lives. And may we sing out a hallelujah praise to you this morning. In the name of Jesus, we pray this and praise you and thank you for your word and the authority of it. Amen. All right. So our musicians are going to go ahead and come on up here. If anybody needs the lyrics, we have them over here. Go ahead and grab some. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet. Now listen, we've gone 2 weeks through this. I hope that the word that you have heard, I hope you're connecting this with what we're about to do. We're outside, so you got to sing louder to be heard. Don't mumble it. You know, don't be like... Man, let it rip! Loud, sing. You're singing to the praises of our Savior. So let's sing out loud here this morning with all you've got in worship of our Lord.
Oh, God's grace is enough. We praise God for that. I thank you so much for being here. Same time next week. Outside, keep praying for good weather. Look, we can have a monsoon Monday through Saturday, but pray for God's protective blessing hand of good weather on Sunday. So we're looking forward to that. Looking forward to having you back here. Let's pray and be dismissed in an attitude of prayer. Almighty, infinite Father, we praise you for your grace, for your mercy, for your love, for your forgiveness. You are more than enough. Your word is enough. God, may we cling to it. May we abide in it. Let it convict us, but let it lead to confession and repentance, and then bring us to worship the one who has forgiven us and made us right with you again. Keep us in your care as we go our separate ways. And let the world see there's a difference in the children of Jesus Christ. In that name alone, we pray all things. Amen.
Amen.
Have a wonderful day.